Good evening, Mount Calvary. God bless. Good to see you all tonight, and welcome to our Wednesday night Bible study. Pray that God's blessings has been upon you. And to those of you who haven't heard me say it, Happy New Year. Praise God. Good to be on again for our first Bible study lesson of 2024. We thank God for each of you tonight being with us. Pray that all is well with you and with your families. We're so excited tonight, as always, to have this opportunity to study together, to pray together, and to worship together. For our study of the Word of God is important not just to us, but also to the God that we serve. For He tells us to study to show ourselves approved unto God, so that we can be workmen need not be ashamed, and we can rightly divide the Word of truth. So again, welcome each of you on tonight, and we thank God for our first Bible study of this year. Tonight, we're going to be led by, in our scripture and our prayer, by Chairman Deacon Irby. Don't see him on. I don't think I saw his name on, so he may not have logged on yet, but we'll progress on as we go through our names and go through those that are on our prayer list. But if not, if I can have another deacon on standby somewhere in here, that would be able to do it if Deacon Irby is not available. Amen. But in our prayer time, we do want to be prayerful for all of our sick and all of our shut-in. We want to be prayerful for those who are requesting prayer and have asked for their names to be placed on our prayer list. So we want to continue to be prayerful for Dr. Jacks. I think as of yesterday, he was still in the hospital, not sure if he's out yet, but we want to continue to pray for Dr. Jacks. We pray that God will strengthen him and continue to strengthen him with recovery. We also want to be prayerful for, again, for Mother Jacks and the whole Jacks family, continue to strengthen them in this time. Keep praying for Dr. Cochran as well. I haven't seen his face, but we still lift him up in prayer. One of the key components of our church and our ministerial staff love him and miss his face. Keep praying for Reverend Williams, too. Again, it's good to see him at church on Sunday, celebrating another birthday. But truly thank God for him and for all of our ministerial staff, our youth pastor, as well as Reverend Stevens and Reverend Stafford and Reverend Henderson and Reverend King. We lift them up in prayer, asking the Lord to strengthen them as well. We also give God praise. I see his own brother Moses Dallas is on our prayer list, but God bless. We thank God for seeing him. We thank God for what God is doing in his life. So hang on in there, Brother Dallas. We continue to lift you up in prayer. Also want to continue to pray for Sister Kathy Mosley. Sometimes, you know, God will give you those praise moments, and you have to just give God his honor. And we thank God for her. We thank God for all that is going on with her, for all that God does is pleasing in his sight. So we, again, ask for prayer for Sister Kathy Moses, Sister Lakeisa Stafford. We continue to pray for her. Pray that God will strengthen her as well, that she can come back to the house of the Lord. She definitely has a desire to come back. We pray that God will give her the physical strength to be able to make it back. So be specific in your prayer when you're praying for her. Ask God to give her strength physically that she can come back. I keep praying for Deacon Wendell and Deaconess Catherine Anderson. We continue to pray for them. Definitely missing their faces, but we do thank God for the both of them. We know God is able to provide for the both of them, and we continue to lift them up to the Lord. So continue to pray for Deacon and Deaconess Anderson. I'll also be in prayer for Mother Carolyn Simmons. She continues to progress, continue to pray God will strengthen her back, that she could get back into the house of the Lord. Mother Arcola, we continue to pray for her as well. Pray God will continue to bless and keep her. I also want to be continue prayer for Brother Levi Riddle. Talk to him Sunday. It's still a blessing to see him and to talk to him. And he was hospitalized for a minute, but we thank God for him. He does a great job with our security there at the church. But we continue to pray for him as well. He is such a great spirit to talk to. Deacon David Mack, keep praying for him as he continues his therapy. Great progression. We thank God for what we're seeing and what God is doing in his life. And we just pray that God will continue to bless him to accomplish all the things that he desires in the Lord. I also want to lift up Sister Yolanda Ponder. I understand that I think she had another surgery, if I'm not mistaken. So we want to be prayerful for Sister Yolanda Ponder and the whole Ponder family. We pray that God will strengthen her and continue to lift them and give them what they need so that they can be continually effective in the Lord. So keep praying for Sister Yolanda Ponder. Deacon and Deaconess Cofield, want to keep praying for them. It was good to see Sister Cofield on service on Sunday. So we continue to pray for both of them that God will strengthen them. Keep praying also for Corey Swain II, LaCorey. We want to continue to pray for him as well. We pray God will bless him and provide what is needed for him as well. So we pray for LaCorey that God will strengthen him. I always say LaCorey, and he's about big as a daddy. Amen. So we continue to pray for Corey Swain II. Also, all of our youth, all of our young adults, all of our young folks, keep them lifted up in prayer. And I know I asked for prayer for Reverend Henderson too, but keep all of our young folks lifted up in prayer. Again, things are just so crazy. Mrs. Swain was just telling me, Sister April told me, you know, she's back in school. They're back in school, and I'm sure they're full of energy and everything else. So pray that God will sustain them, bring them down where they need to be so that they can get back in learning mode. But we do pray for all of our teachers, administrators, those who are dealing with our children as well. So we lift them up in prayer. Also ask for, finally, those who are affected by these storms that just came through. These tornadoes, and the rain and the storm that just came through. I know down in South Georgia, North Florida, there was some damages down in that area. I know Panama City area was hit pretty bad again. But all down through that panhandle area, pray that God will bless those people down in that area who was impacted by the storm. So if you know anybody down there, try to give them a call, check up on them. To make sure that they're okay, for we know God is still able to take care of those, even if we can't get to, we know God can take care of them. Amen. So again, thank you all so much, and I know there's other names, there's so many more, but if I forgot a name or a person, please charge it to my head, not to my heart. But if there's a name of somebody you do want on our prayer list, just let us know. And we will add them to our prayer list on our Wednesday night time of prayer. So with that, I see Deacon Irby is on now. So I'm going to turn it over to Deacon Irby as he's going to lead us tonight in our scripture reading and our prayer. All right. So you there, Deacon Irby? I think I turned you. There you go.
Yeah. Well, good evening, everyone. Hope you all having a great day. Our scripture reading will be coming from Deuteronomy chapter 6. And we'll be reading about four verses from five verses, verse 10 through 14. And it says, "And it shall be when the Lord thy God shall have brought thee into the land which he sware unto thy fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to give thee great and goodly cities which thou buildest not." In verse 11, "And houses full of all good things which thou fillest not, and well digged which thou diggest not, vineyards, olive trees, which thou planted not, when thou shall have eaten and be full, then beware, lest thou forget the Lord, which brought thee out from out of the land of Egypt, from the house of bondage. Thou shalt fear the Lord thy God, and serve him, and shall swear by his name. Ye shall not go after other gods of the gods of the people which are round about you. So he's encouraged us to follow him. And we'll look to the Lord in prayer. Our Father, the God of our salvation, the one who's covered us and keeping us and directing our steps. Father God, we pray, Lord, that you will look upon each and every member of the Mount Calvary Church family, those that are sick, those that are struggling with other issues. Whatever it might be, Lord, we pray that you will cover them. You will let them know, let us know, that you will be with us. And as your word says, you'll never leave us nor forsake us. So, Father God, we thank you that we have that great relationship with you. Lord, that we can look to you. Whatever we're faced with, whether sickness, whether finance, whether mental or whatever, Lord, we pray, Lord, that we'll look to you, that you will guide us, that you will direct our steps. Lord, that you will bring us to the place that you will have us to be. So, Lord, Father God, we thank you for your healing power. We thank you, Lord, for your salvation power. We thank you, Lord, for your saving power. So, Father God, we pray, Lord, as we look into your word, pray, Lord, that you bless Pastor Gurley as he bring the word to us. Lord, we ask you to open our hearts, our mind, and that we might receive your word, Lord, that we might grow thereby. So, Father God, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you, Lord, for the family you give us, not only just our immediate family, but the Mount Calvary Church family. So, Father God, we pray, Lord, that we'll honor you in everything that we say and do, that we will bring glory and honor to your holy name. Bless us, Lord, and help us, Lord, to continue to look to you, continue to look for your protection and your umbrella over us. Because, Lord, we know that we can't protect ourselves. We know, Lord, that we have a great provider. So, Father God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy and your love and your provision for us. Now, Father God, I ask you to open hearts and minds that we might receive your word as it go out, that we may bring glory and honor to your holy name. Thee, Lord, another blessing we ask in your Son Jesus' name, for his sake alone. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Dick, for leading us in our prayer and in our scripture, and such a blessing just to hear the thankfulness to God for his grace and for his mercy. For even our lesson tonight kind of deals with that very same thing. So again, thank you, each of you, for being a part of our devotion, our prayer, and whatever you have asked the Lord for. Just have faith and just believe that God can, and God does have the power, authority, and ability to answer your prayer. So thank you so much. So again, welcome and good evening to those of you who haven't spoken to yet. We thank God for you for being on with us tonight, and we pray that you are ready to jump back into our Bible study lesson, that you are ready to get back into this book of Ephesians, and we can learn more about what Paul has been expressing and teaching in this book, that I'm praying that it's bringing you the type of joy that it brings to my heart to study it and to teach it, and even the things that the Holy Spirit is illuminating for us things that we see that we may not have seen before. And I'm so grateful for, again, the lead guidance of the Holy Spirit in leading this particular book to be part of our church theme for 2024, of being chosen. And I pray that as we continue to study this book, even tonight, that we operate in that fashion of knowing that we have been chosen and what God's plan is. So thank you so much for studying with us. And what I want to do is kind of bring us up to speed. I know we've had a good break, and I know that we haven't had our time off. We ain't doing no quiz tonight. Ain't gonna be no New Year's Grinch. Ain't gonna do that to you, sir. So we're not doing a quiz or anything, but just want to reflect back over what we've been talking about, because we're in chapter two now. And in chapter two, some revealing things that we have seen thus far. And I know we left off at verse number four, which we'll jump back into on tonight. But those first three verses in chapter number two really is just a reminder, Mount Calvary, of how bad we were. And it deals with us. It deals with humanity. It deals with our situation we were in prior to our relationship with Christ. It was our pre-renewed state when we were dead in trespasses and sins. And we've talked about these things and what they mean. And hopefully these are the type of words that are encouraging you, because it says this is what we were, not what we are. And to know where we came from is always a blessing. And even as Paul expresses in here, even though he's talking to the Ephesians, he's talking to the believer, that we walked according to the world, the ways of the world. We fit right in with them. We walked according to the world. Satan is the one that was guiding our footsteps, whether we want to acknowledge it or not. We were not walking according to the way of God. We were walking according to the way of the world. And in the midst of all of that, he still had chosen us. And it wasn't anything new to God. He already knew all of these things. But as we walked, we had our, as I said in verse three, we had our conversation. We talked just like folks that we look at now and say need to be saved. We lived just like they're living now. We may not have been as bad as some people, but anything contrary to God is ungodly. Hello, somebody. So whatever way it was, we were still a part of that group. We were trying to satisfy the lust of our flesh and the lust of our mind. And by nature, the text says that we were just like the children of wrath. In essence, we were those who deserved God's punishment. But we talked about it in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, how now since we have accepted Christ, there is now therefore no condemnation. God is not mad at us. God is not upset with us. God is not frustrated with us. God ain't looking to punish us. So again, I pray that these things will help you to live in a fashion that even when we come short of the glory of God, we know that God still loves us. And God is not mad at us. So don't think that when we come short of it, his glory has surprised him, because it didn't. God already knew that. The fact is, we didn't know. So that's kind of where we left off. I know we jumped into that verse four, but I'm going to stop right there, because I'm going to jump back in to that verse four on tonight. Amen. So I hope you have your outlines. I hope you have your Bibles. I hope you're ready to jump back in here and pray that the Spirit would lead and guide us through this thing in the fashion that he sees fit. So let us bow very quickly as we go into our study. Heavenly Father, again, thank you so much for our time of studying your word. Lord, I pray now that you would lead and guide us according to your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that we would be receptive to that which your Spirit is leading to us. And Lord, as you speak to us, I pray that you would give us clarity, that you would give us understanding of your word, Lord, not for a show to the world, but that we can live in a fashion that's pleasing unto you. Lord, we need you tonight. We need you to open your word to us by way of your Holy Spirit, that we, Lord, can study and be effective in our study of your word. So now, Lord, I pray that you would remove any hindering spirits, anything that's stopping us from learning your words, I pray that you give us a singleness of heart and a singleness of mind as we study, Lord, to glorify you. So we thank you, Lord. I pray for those who couldn't get on tonight. Pray for those who are on their way to try to make it on, Lord. But whoever's going to be on, Lord, I pray that you would have your way in our lives tonight. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. And we all can say amen. And thank God. Amen. All right. So we had seen, as we were talking about in those first three verses, again, a lot of information. It presented to us our hopeless condition. That's kind of how I wrap it up. Verses 1 through 3 show just how hopeless we were. And if you don't believe that, go back and read it yourself. Verses 1 through 3 deals with the hopelessness of someone who doesn't have Christ in their life, dead in trespasses and sin, and children of wrath. Yeah, that's a hopeless situation. But what we see is the hopeless condition of an unsaved person. But when we get to verse number 4, where we jump back in tonight, we see this "but God" statement, where it says, "but God," God being the object of whatever is getting ready to happen. But is, you know, that's a contrastive conjunction. Something different is being said, but God is the subject of what is getting ready to be said. Verses 1 through 3, we were the subject. The unsaved were the subject in verses 1 through 3. But starting at verse number 4, God is the subject. So it's like the text, Paul shifts gears in his writing to confirm to us, how bad we were. But then he gets to this verse 4 and says, but God. And when we think of our own selves and our own walk with God, I say to you, whenever you think about how bad you were and what you used to do, when you get finished thinking about you, say, but God. Amen. When you think about your bad self and everything else, just end that whole statement with but God, because that's exactly what Paul did here. He says that even though we by nature, sure, he says, but God. And I'm going to read verse 4, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherewith he loved us. Now, this is impactful. I kind of laid into this thing a little bit today, trying to pray on it and try to get some additional insights, because it says, but God, and then it gives these attributes of God. It gives this attribute, rather. It begins to talk about God's love. That why would there even be a but God statement at the end of our mess, other than because of the fact that God loves us? I mean, our mess should end with a period, exclamation point, paragraph, but it doesn't. It ends with but God. And this idea that says, but God, who is rich in mercy for his great love wherein he loved us. Now, I'm going to tell you why this is important, because love itself, most theologians, you've heard it too, that love is an attribute of God. In essence, love is what God is. And it's what you would call an intrinsic attribute. It's in him. It's who he is. God doesn't try to love. God is love. And because it's intrinsic, and it's because it's who he is, the question becomes, if God is love, what does it look like? What does it look like when God demonstrates that love toward us? What does it look like? We say, well, God loved me. Well, what does it look like? Well, you can't look and say, oh, this love right here. What does it look like? Well, that's the relative attribute of God. The intrinsic part is this in him, but relative, how does it relate to others? What does it look like when he demonstrates that love toward us? It looks like grace and mercy. Grace and mercy is nothing but a physical manifestation of God's love for us. When God says, I'll love you, we always talk about love as an action word. And so, okay, God loves you. You say that. What action do you have? Well, we know for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. We say, okay, that's an action word. But what was that? That was grace. That was a demonstration of undeserved favor that we received. And that's all grace and mercy is. Yeah, grace is just receiving something that you not receiving that something that you do deserve, and mercy and grace is receiving something that you don't deserve. And what God does is he shows his love toward us. And when he does, it comes out as grace and mercy. And when you say that, when I say that, rather, it's just the idea of, man, God, you love me so much that you provide me with something that I don't deserve. What is it? That's your love. That's a demonstration of your love. And you're not trying to love because you are love. I hope it makes sense to you. That's why I say I had to delve into it, because we're going to see these phrases. Even in verse 4, we saw rich in mercy. But by the time we get to verse 7, we don't see rich in grace. So anytime you see grace, you normally see mercy somewhere, because those two go hand in hand. They are, again, these physical manifestations of God's love. And so if you like, does God love me? Think about mercy. Has he shown you any favor? Has he held back something from you that you deserve? And some folks may look at that the wrong way. Well, the wages of sin is death, but you're still here. Hello, somebody. That's again God's mercy, God's grace at work. He holds back that which we deserve, and he gives us something that we don't deserve. But the gift of God is eternal life. We don't deserve that. That's just fully by his grace and by his mercy. That is a reflection of his love for us. And again, when we go back to that John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his son. That was all this mercy piece, something that we don't deserve, but he still did it for us. And when I told you, I think the other week when we was talking about this phrase rich in mercy, that word mercy in the Greek is aletos. It means undeserved kindness. That God shows us this undeserved kindness when the text says he's rich in mercy, he's rich in this undeserved kindness toward us. And notice that statement follows the but God. But the but God follows how bad we were. We were rich in mess. We were rich in disobedience. We was rich in lies. Hello, somebody. All of those things we were, but it says, but God, who's rich in mercy, who's rich in giving us undeserved kindness. And when you even look at that word deeper, the word aleos is translated in the Hebrew to the Greek word, and the Hebrew word hesed, which means love. So we back to it again. So when you start thinking about mercy, it translates into love. That is a physical manifestation of God's love for us. And I hope that as we read this text, when it talks about what God has done, because we what we did and how we acted, but now we're starting to look at what God did. First of all, it says who he is before he says what he is. Rich in mercy, for his great love where which he loved us. And we know that word love there is his agape love toward us. It's a unconditional love. It's a this undeserved love. There's nothing that you and I did to make God love us. Amen. We ain't so good. We can't look in the mirror and say, God love me because my hair looked like this, or God love me because I'm XYZ. No, in spite of. That's the thing about God's love. It's not because of, it's in spite of. He loves us. And as the text says, when we were dead in trespasses, and we'll get to that. He says, but God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us. So let me say this. I'm going on to my next verse. Please know and understand that the love that God has for us is something that you and I should be able to feel in our hearts if you're saved. Because folks are going to walk away. People are going to talk about you. Things are not always going to go your way. But just because those things occur in your life don't mean that God don't love you. God's love is not based on this stuff. God's love is not based on the challenges of life. God love you if you ain't got no troubles. But why? Because it's who he is. He is love. He is just a God who just showers us with this undeserved kindness. So as we read this and we think about how bad we were and see how good God is, we see one that he's rich in mercy. He's rich in extending to us this undeserved kindness, and he do it because he loves us. So note in your 2024 list of things that you want to put down, you want to put some of the unchosen, you can put right up under, he loves me. Because it's in the word, we're seeing that already. So it doesn't matter what other people think about you. The only thing that matters is what your God thinks about you and your relationship with him. But look how Paul goes on and he says, this is God who's rich in mercy for his great love, where when he loved us, he flips for a second just to remind us, because we can get to the end of our statement and say, yeah, I was bad, but God. And then we'll get so focused on God that we'll forget who we were back up in verses 1-3. Amen. So he says in verse number 5, he says that even this God who's rich in mercy, and he demonstrated this even when we were dead in sin, when we were at the lowest place we could be, he demonstrated undeserved kindness toward us while we were dead spiritually. And remember what we talked about, this thing of spiritual death. We could not communicate with God. We could not connect with God because God is a spirit. We serve him in spirit and in truth. And if you're spiritually dead, there's no way that you can respond to spiritual things. Why? Because you're spiritually dead. You're physically alive, but you're spiritually dead. So the things of God, we couldn't respond to. But God, who's rich in mercy for his love for us, even when we couldn't respond to him, look what he did. The text says that even when we were dead, he quickened us together. When we couldn't respond to him, he did something to make us be able to respond to him. That's deep to me, because he could have left us where we were. You ever seen somebody walk by folk who need help and just, you know, go to the other side of the street, all that kind of stuff, and just don't even pay them no attention? I mean, God could have did that to us. He just walked right on by us and kept it moving. But the text says, because of who he is, because he is a God that loves the way that he does, he saw our situation even when we were at our lowest point, when we were dead, when we were separated spiritually, when we were caught up in sin. As the text says, we were dead in sin. We were missing the mark, hamartios. We were missing the target that God had set for humanity, and we was hitting something else, so we weren't even thinking about him. While we were doing all that, the text says he had quickened us together with Christ. While we were in that situation, I told you when we got to verse 5, we'll talk a little bit about this word quicken. The word quicken here does not respond to the fact that God is fast, even though he is. He's amazingly fast. But this term here, quicken, is the Greek word sousopouio. Is what it is. Sousopouio is this Greek word. It means to make alive spiritually. So this is what God did. When we were unable to respond to him because we were in such a sad state, he did something to cause us to be able to hear him, respond to him, have knowledge of him, and have insight of him. We saw that back in chapter 1, that pray that God will give them insight and understanding, knowledge, so that they can know who God is. And that's what he has done for us. And he did it when we were at our lowest state. Now, why is that so important? It's because you hear sometimes folks say, when I get it right, I give my life to Christ. So what you're saying is, when I come up some, I'll give my life to Christ. Now, God needs you down that way in that low area. Amen. Because pride will make you think you know something that you don't. Pride will make you think that the only reason God chose you is because I started doing such and such. And not you basing this thing on you. But when you down in that low pass, as I'm in that low place, even when we were dead in trespasses, and even when we could not respond to the word of God if we wanted to, because there was nothing in us connecting us to him, we were so separated from him, he did something. And the text says that he quickened us, he made us alive spiritually. And notice he said us, the believers, all of those who have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, because it's done through Christ. He said he brought us alive together with Christ. Here is the thing about the crucifixion of Christ and the sacrifice that Christ made for us. Prior to the sacrificial atonement that Jesus made for us, yes, Israel was God's chosen people, but there was still a program in place to cover their sins and not to forgive their sins. Hello, somebody. Because the sacrificial sins just covered them. Even when they would, the Mosaic law in the sacrificial system of forgiveness of bringing animals and sacrificing, all of that was pointing towards something. It was a foreshadowing of the great Lamb, who was Jesus Christ. Everything that you saw in the law of them bringing animals and the blood of the animals sprinkled on the mercy seat. Why? For these sins to be covered. And that's why they would cover it with blood. But now we know that when Jesus died on Calvary, it was the blood of Jesus. That blood, that pure blood, not the blood as Hebrew talks about of heifers and sheep and rams. We don't need that anymore. Why? Because as John said, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world, he's going to be led to the a slaughter as a sheep. And that's what Jesus did when he went to Calvary. When he died on Calvary, all the sins of the world were placed on him. Even those sins of past, present, and future were placed on him so that anybody who believes in the Lord Jesus Christ can be saved. So when we think about how intense that was and how important the sacrifice of Christ was and what he did, the text says that when we were dead, he quickened us together, which means that because he already knew who, when, where, who he's going to choose, all this, when he died, all of us at that point in Christ, notice the text says, it happened in Christ. That it wasn't like in the eyesight of God, Deacon Irby got his salvation before I got mine. Not in the eyesight of God. That's not how it works with God. What God did, he did it once, as the Bible says, once and for all. When he went to Calvary, he did it once and for all. He didn't have to go be crucified again for me. He didn't have to go be crucified again for another person. No, he did it once and for all. And he already knew within himself who would accept him as Lord and Savior. So when he says that he quickened us together, the idea is in Christ, that he is the one who did. I want you to turn with me somewhere. I meant to read something earlier, but I may come back to that. Turn with me to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8. Okay. Got it here. And look at Romans chapter 8. I want to begin reading at verse 11. And here's what it says. It says, but if the spirit of him being God the Father, that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also, here's that word, quicken your mortal bodies, shall give life to spiritual life to your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwells in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live after the flesh, for if we live after the flesh, ye shall die. But But if ye through the Spirit do mortify or kill the deeds or the sinful desires of the flesh, he said, ye shall live. Why? Because the Spirit of God dwells in us. When I read that, we can turn back over here to Ephesians. When I read that, it kind of makes me think of a dead battery, that there's no life in it. But when you hook a good battery to it, all of a sudden, the dead battery gets life put to it. It gets energy put to it. We were dead. We were that dead battery until God made the decision to connect to us and put life in us. And not the life that was previously in the battery, but a new life in us. This new energy that he has placed in us. And he quickened us together in Christ. And the text says, by grace we are saved. Now, we're going to see that again down at verse number 8. So you can mark, and in my Bible, it's in parentheses. That's in parentheses in your Bible. When you see that phrase, by grace, you're saved. And sometimes that's put there as an emphasis because he's going to discuss it again later. So we see here says that even when we were dead in trespassing sin, at Lord's point, God gave us spiritual life so that we can communicate with him, not just you, but me too, all of us whom he has chosen. He gave us the ability to connect with him, but we connect with the Father. How? Through Christ. What did Jesus say? No man cometh to the Father, but by me. So now we have a way to talk to the Father through Christ, because now we have something in us that allows us to connect with him. What is it? It's Holy Spirit that now is in us. And he says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will pray to the Father. He will give you a spirit, a comforter that will lead and guide you in the truth and righteousness. So that's why we can connect with God, because of what he put in us, not because of us, but because of him. His choice. What an amazing God that chooses us to instill and to implant or to impart to us something that we don't deserve. And he did it because he's God, and he just gives this undeserved kindness to whom he chooses. And the thing I love about God, he's omniscient. He can do whatever he want to do. Amen. And the thing I said, and I overlooked it, and I do want to go back to it because I think it's important. In verse 4, where it says, God who is rich in mercy. And we talked about how mercy being a relative attribute of God's love, or this physical manifestation of God's love, is shown in his mercy. I want you to turn with me to Psalms 103. I read this, and I said I wanted to make sure I share it with you, because Psalms 103, I mean, I want to begin reading at verse 8, because we talked about how grace and mercy goes together. Every time we see this mercy, we see grace. But in Psalms 103, David wrote this in verse number 8, started there. He says, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, plenteous in, there it is again, mercy. He would not always chide, neither will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us after our sins, nor reward us according to our iniquities. For as the heaven is high above the earth, so great is, here it is, his mercy toward them that fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so has he removed our transgressions from us. Why? Because he is a merciful God. Right, go back over here to Ephesians. I mean, I need you to understand the extent of God's, as the text says, in verse 4, the riches of his mercy, the plenteousness of his kindness toward us when we know we don't deserve it, to the point that he quickens us and gives us this ability to be able to respond to him. Now that we can respond to him, he has brought us together and reminded us that you're saved by, here it is, you're saved by this undeserved kindness. So when we look in the mirror, don't beat your chest. Ooh, I did it right. God chose, in spite of that, God chose you because he saw us when we were dead. He saw us when we didn't have the capability of communicating with him. And that's when he made the decision to say, I'm going to show mercy toward them. And that mercy is what caused me and you to respond to him. And please note that anytime we do anything, it's a response to what God has already done. We don't initiate nothing. Hello, somebody. Well, how I went to church only because God woke you up. Hello, somebody. I sang in the choir only because God gave you a voice to sing with. Everything is a response to him. He is first. That's why he says he's out there at the beginning and the end. It all begins and it ends with him as God. So, and like I said, that last phrase in verse number 5 that says, by grace are you saved, we're going to come back to it because we're going to see that again in verse number 8. And I want to delve deeper into it when we get in verse number 8. But I think that was a preface of Paul putting that there to let him know that he is going to say that again. But when he gets to verse 6, he says, in verse 5, he says, when we didn't trust by sin, you know, he quickened us together. And by the time we get to verse 6, that A clause says, and he has raised us up together. Now, I'm going to pause at that A clause. So we went through verses 1 through 3 talking about how bad we were and all those things that we had did. But we get three short verses. Matter of fact, two verses and an A clause. Verse 4, verse 5, and the A clause of verse 6. We find out that God loves us. We find out that God quickened us, and we find out that God has raised us or exalted us. All when we were dead in trespasses and sins. I think that is amazing, that it doesn't take much for God to show us how much he's done for us. Now, and I say this parenthetically, by way of God's spirit, is the only way we're going to appreciate verses 4, 5 in that A clause, even the whole verse 6, is by the Spirit of God. That's the only way we'll appreciate it. That is the only way we will appreciate it, is when the Spirit of God helps you to see in his word that because of me and my love that I have for you, that you can say, okay, God, you love me. And then you can say, man, when I was dead in trespassing and sin, I did something to give you the capability to communicate with me because I quickened you and I gave you spiritual life. Thank you, Lord. Because other than that, I couldn't have talked to you if I wanted to. I couldn't connect with you if I wanted to. And then you come and tell me that you have now raised us up together. You have exalted or elevated me to a place that I never would have been if you had not done what you've done. And notice that each one of these verses, each one of these things, his love for us, quickened us, and raised us, is all in past tense. Which means, it does not mean that God will love us, or that he will quicken us, or he will raise us. No, he has already done it. That's past tense. That's why we've got to operate, listen, Calvary, in what we have and not necessarily in what we're expecting to get. I already have God's love. I already been quickened. God has already connected me with him and gave me the ability to be able to understand his word. That's his doing. I ain't sitting around here waiting, saying, Lord, one day you let me understand this. No, you already did it. And I can connect with him, and he can connect with me in his word. And now in this 8 clause of verse 6, and he raised us or exalted us up together and made us to sit in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. I often say that we should take notice to things that are repeated in the scripture. If you have already seen this, You need to pay attention to it if it shows up again. Yeah, we know Paul wrote it, but the Bible says that all scripture is inspired by God, that men wrote as the Holy Spirit moved upon them. So if Paul put it in here twice, it ain't because Paul wanted to put it in here twice. It's because the Spirit led him to put it in here twice. Because if you go all the way back over to chapter 1, verse number 3, and here's what you see. Blessed be the God of our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Now we go over to chapter 2. And when we get back over here to chapter 2, and we get to verse number 6, and what does it say? That he has raised us up together and places where was Jesus again. Notice that context. Notice the context of what we're seeing here. It's not done by us, it's done by him. So I need you to think of it this way. Currently, right now, our physical position is on earth, but our spiritual position is in heavenly places. Right now, me and you, we walking around down here on earth. We got to live here on earth, but our spiritual position is in Christ. What does 2 Corinthians 5:17 say? If any man be what? In Christ, he's a new creature. So we are in Christ. Where is Christ? Seated at the right hand of the Father. So in Christ, we have already been seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Yeah, I got to live down here, but I already know where I am spiritually. I'm seated in heavenly places. That's what the word tells me. And it doesn't tell me that once. It tells me that twice in the same book. I need you to grasp that. Because when we think of that verse 4, when he's talking about being chosen, God seated us in places because he did it through his son Jesus. And as this verse number 6 says, that he has raised us up. And that thing of being seated in heavenly places in Christ, we have been exalted to a level that we didn't have before God did what he did to connect us so that we can have a relationship with him. That elevation piece, we couldn't have did that. We couldn't have made our way into the heavenly places. Knowledge couldn't have put us there. Our money couldn't put us there. Well, how in the world did we get there? As the text says, in Christ. If we believe and we know that we have accepted him as Lord and Savior, we believe that he is the Son of God. We believe what the word says about him as the Son of God when he says, you shall be saved. Now you become the recipients of this which he promises. So, he has made us past tense. I know only thing sometimes we see is what's going on down here. And sometimes you got to start seeing in the spirit, what in the world does that look like? Lord, I'm going through trouble. I know I'm going through trouble, but you as God, is your peaceful God. You're God who can give me a peace that passes all understanding. You are a God that has the capability of controlling my mind and getting me on track with you and knowing that trouble don't last always. Help me to endure whatever I have to endure. Why? Because God sits in places that our minds can't even fathom. God is peace. And God can cause that same peace to come down upon us. And sometimes folks don't grasp it. Some folk can't get it, but you can be so mad and so upset. And then you start praying and connecting with God. And all of a sudden you ain't as mad as you were, you know, came down, you're feeling better. And now you're kind of like, well, I need to tell that person, I'm sorry. I need to go back and apologize. Why? Because God has a way. He'll give you a peace that passes all understanding. This is verse says that God has exalted us. I say this in kind of closing, that we need to stop, again, looking for that validation from people, looking for validation in the world, to even preach about it on Sunday, knowing that you have been chosen. I don't want that to be just a line or a cliche or something that just makes you feel good in your head. I need you to know it to be true. And knowing it to be true, it kind of puts a emphasis on all of the stuff that we've seen tonight. I know that he loves me. And because he loves me, there's no greater love than his love for me. And I know that he's given me this spiritual life. He's quickened me. He's given me this spiritual connection with him, because even when ain't nobody else around, I can still feel him. And even when I don't hear no physical voices, I feel him in my spirit. That's his presence. That's his connection with me. And then to know even that which my eyes can't see, that he has exalted me in Christ to sit in heavenly places. And even knowing that he's sitting there, I may not be there physically, but I am there spiritually. And knowing that this is what he says to me, I can sit and sometimes have a smile on my face. I ain't say have a perfect day every day. That ain't what I'm saying. Because we all gonna have some bad days. And some say we have some good days. We have some heels to climb. But there ought to be some days that you kind of sit and reflect on what you already have in Christ. And here's the thing, and again, I don't want to over-spiritualize stuff. God can bless you here on earth. He will bless you here. He will give you the desires of your heart here. God will open up doors for you here. But the things that we lay up in heaven, when he says, lay your treasures up in heaven, those things ain't got nothing to do with down here. How do I lay up my treasures? It's how I love one another. It's how I forgive one another. That's laying up treasures. But sometimes down here, we're too busy worrying about tangible treasures. Lord, I need a couple of dollars to be able to pay my bill. I can give you that too. And I'm a living witness. Sometimes God will bless you in places from places that you didn't even expect. But it's done by faith. You just got to always believe, trust in God. So knowing that you're chosen, knowing that you have been quick, and knowing that you are loved by God, and knowing that he has elevated us in him to sit in places that we have never can't even imagine, that this is what he has done for us, it should cause us to appreciate verses 4, 5, and 6. Man, I'm somebody in the eyesight of God. I don't care what nobody else says. And when you walk around from one day to the next, you walk around with your head up. You walk around believing. I don't care what the doctors or anybody else says. I am loved by the true and the living God. I am given life by him. And he is the one who will provide all of our needs according to his riches in glory. Amen? Amen. All right, so we'll take up at verse number 7. Thank y'all again so much. Always a blessing to study together. Always a blessing to delve into the word. And thank you all so much for joining us. Thank you all for being with us on tonight. So let us pray as we close out. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you again so much for our time and your word together. Pray, Lord, that your word will take root in our hearts and grow. And I pray, Lord, that there was something that was said tonight that encouraged someone's spirit, that, Lord, they can know that you love them more than they could ever know. And, Lord, that you have even raised them up in places that their eyes have not seen. And, Father, that you are the one who has given them your spirit so that they can connect with you. So we thank you tonight, God, for showing us, revealing to us, Lord, illuminating to us how much you love us. And tonight, again, thank you for our study together. Thank you for all that we're able to get on. And Father, I pray that you would bless us at the next appointed time that we can come together and study again. Bless our sick. Bless our shut-in. Lord, continue to be the amazing God that you are. And Lord, and until we can come together again, we will continue to give you glory, honor, and praise. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And thank God. Amen. God bless you all. Again, so good to see you all on. God bless and pray that y'all have a great week. Hey, mommy, how you doing? God bless. So good to see all of you on, and we look forward to seeing you on Saturday, those of you who come to the church meeting. Amen. So we look forward to seeing you on Saturday at our church conference. God bless you. God keep you. Y'all have a wonderful week. Amen. God bless y'all.